Ladies and gentlemen, again, welcome. We will begin this portion of the service with an invocation offered by Corey Lucchini, a close friend of the Burright family. Corey?
Wow, what a guy, huh? Absolutely amazing individual. What an honor it is to me, for me, to have walked briefly alongside of John. Having never met John, I was surprised when, in prayer one day, God told me I'd be meeting John, and as a massage therapist, that I'd be working with John. This was several weeks after his injury, and although I had no clue how this arrangement could possibly occur, well, God, of course, had no problem lining up the appropriate chance meetings and to direct my steps. Well, soon, I was meeting with a spunky redhead named Rhonda. Thank you, Rhonda, for inviting me into your family. When Rhonda asked me to say a prayer today, I asked the Lord, is there a scripture I can share? And right away, he took me to 2 Timothy 4, 5 through 8. And 4:18. And these are Paul's words to Timothy, written as he was constrained and restricted as a consequence of service to God and mankind, as was John. These words in the scriptures describe John's character, his sacrifice, and his certain safe arrival into God's heavenly kingdom. These are Paul's words. As for you, be calm and cool and steady. Accept and suffer unflinchingly every hardship. Do the work of an evangelist. Fully perform all the duties of your ministry. For I am already about to be sacrificed. My life is to be poured out as a drink offering. The time of my spirit's release from this body is at hand, and I will soon go free. I have fought the good, worthy, honorable and noble fight. I have finished the race. I have kept firmly held the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me the victor's crown of righteousness, for being right with God and doing right, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will award to me and compensate me on that great day. Not only to me, but all those who have loved and yearned for his appearing. And then in verse 18. Indeed, the Lord will certainly deliver and draw me to himself from every source of evil. He will preserve me and bring me safe into his heavenly kingdom. To him be the glory forever and ever. Amen. We can all agree that we have been blessed to have run the race with John. Psalm 139 is clear that God knits us in our mother's womb, that he determines our days, that he goes before us and behind us. Indeed, he hems us in all the days of our life. God knit John's character with strength, courage, love, ferocious compassion, tremendous endurance, and a fantastic sense of humor. I will always hold precious memories of my time spent together with John. Like that twinkle in his eye, and that accompanied by that very big smile as he played a funny, mischievous move. That same twinkle and smile lit his face when he heard Rhonda's voice in the hall and coming into the room. John is an amazing one of a kind. Let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for allowing us to come together today. Thank you for the safe travels getting here. Thank you for laughter with friends and tears with friends. Lord, bring healing to our broken places. Father, strengthen our weaknesses. Give us courage and endurance to live each day to the fullest. Lord, it's Rhonda's desire that you protect and equip every peace officer as well as their families. Lord, protect them as they travel throughout our communities. To Direct their steps as they strive to complete each day's work. Lord, grant them divine wisdom, peace, and safety as you cover them each with your mighty righteous right hand.
Thank you, Corey, for the inspiring words in that beautiful prayer. I consider it such a privilege to be here today and assist as we honor a cherished husband, father, dear friend, brother, cousin, and law enforcement colleague, John Burright. My comments are going to be brief, as I do not know John as well as many of you. I married his cousin, Patty, several years after the accident that injured him. But from the stories I've heard time and again from Patty, I feel like I know him. And from knowing his wife, Rhonda, and his sons, Jeremy, Kyle, and Nolan, I have a strong sense of the quality of his personality and the strength of his character. I actually kind of stand here representing both myself and my wife. She has been his cousin, and they grew up very close. They were born just one day apart, with John being born first. Patty always referred to him as Big John, and she teased him that he was her much older cousin. They spent a great deal of time together as children and teenagers, camping, hunting for frogs, catching pollywogs, going to church camps, singing carpenter songs at the top of their lungs in that first car of his, the Gold Duster. And later going on ride-alongs with him in his work as a police officer, seeing him in his official capacity and admiring his work, and even enjoying the occasional humorous adventure with him during those ride-alongs, like the time they saw a big frog on the road, stopped and put it in the sack so he could take it home to his young son, Kyle. And Patty had to hold that jumping, wiggly sack on her lap until he had a break long enough to take it. Patty loved Big John, and loves Big John. In the years I've known her, we regularly stop in at the Mennonite home to visit him, and I've seen how her face is lit up, and he has smiled and laughed in response, as she would reminisce about some of the stories and antics of their childhood together. She misses him terribly now, and not a day goes by, but she thinks of him and feels gratitude for the privilege of having him in her life. Patty is one of many who have been touched, strengthened, entertained, and loved by this man. We're going to have the pleasure now of hearing from several of those today. And first, we'll have the opportunity to hear from John's oldest son, Kyle. Kyle?
I'm not much of a crier, but my kryptonite is throwing me in crying, so if all you fellas in the front row can keep it together here, that'd be much appreciated. There's so many people I'd like to thank for the support they've shown my family, and regrettably, we won't be able to see everyone that's traveled here today, so thank you for honoring my father. We really appreciate you all. To our OSP family and other local law enforcement agencies, the Fallen Badge Foundation, the Honor Guard, thank you for not making us feel forgotten for all these years and for taking care of my family. To the staff of the Mennonite Village, thank you for keeping my father happy and healthy for all those years, and it was almost 20 years that he was there with you guys. It was really reassuring that we had such wonderful people there looking after him at all times. Corey, thank you, for the massages and spending time with my father. I know you cherish that. And also Mr. Rob Hayes, thank you for being amazing to my family. And a mentor to me, helping me get where I am today. My family loves you very much. To my Uncle Dave, thank you for the unconditional brotherly love spending all that time there with him, reading, talking to him, among other things. I know that the Hulu Girl calendars definitely helped. And thank you for doing something that I just didn't have the strength to do myself. My grandparents also spent many hours by their son's side, and all that took away a mountain of burden from me, knowing that you were all there for him as often as you were, so thank you so much. You know, several years ago, past the mark where I spent more time without my dad physically being around than I had with him, but the impact that he's had on me really lasted through all these years. He was a real dad. Jean shorts and long white socks to prove it. And he showed me a great blueprint for raising children. He always put his kids first. Even working evenings, holidays, overtime. He still attended practice and games and events, sometimes even coaching them himself. And that eventually ended up helping pay our way through college and teach us an abundance of life's lessons. I mean, the guy literally bought catcher's gear at age like 38 to help my brother and I continue to learn how to pitch. He probably still has bruised shins and palms. Sorry, Dad. And having kids on my own, I can really only appreciate that all the more. The late night TV, messing around with my buddies when they stay over at our house, always making them feel welcome, always being willing to share advice or help how we could for some of those that didn't have strong father figures in their lives. He snuck in one time, and he scared the crap out of us. We were supposed to be asleep in the middle of the night. Brought in his tactical shotgun, cocked that in the kitchen real loud. My buddy still tells that story like 20 years later. He used to keep my brothers and I occupied somehow. Wherever we went, it was a crazy skill that he had. We'd be playing games in the car on road trips, or when we went to stores like Home Depot, he'd have something for little pieces of lumber on the floor, or some kind of inanimate object that we could kick around like a soccer ball while we were there. The game always ended with it going under one of the aisles. Classic. But my favorite thing we did every year was a 2-week camping trip capped off with a company softball tournament in Bend. What a bunch of hooligans, by the way. I have such fond memories of camping with our extended family during that trip and all the activities that came with it. Dad enjoyed some quiet time and dove a lot with Uncle Dave in the lakes, but mainly he was just running around like crazy with those kids, biking around, catching toads. He was a giant kid, teaching us along the way how to enjoy the outdoors. All forever be grateful for that. I could share stories about Dad for hours, like the time we were fishing off the jetty in Newport, he hooked into one of those black diving birds. He got the thing up on the rocks and it just went nuts. He was trying to get the hook out of it, he was just biting the crap out of it. I've been fishing out there for over 20 years and I still haven't seen that again. Or like the time where we snuck into the embarcadero to fish one night. I was probably about 10 years old. I guess he used to work security there, but what I didn't realize is that he'd been casing the place the whole time to figure out how in the world we were going to get in there to do some fishing. Just two guys standing out in front of the fisher out in the dark, nothing to see here, you know? The fishing was so great that night, though, that even though we got back at like midnight, Mom couldn't even be mad because I had such a great time. There was another time we were down at the local middle school, kicking field goals and playing catch with the football. Dad used to run laps on the track there sometimes to stay in shape for work. And he got a phone call that one of his friends had died. I assume some of you have had similar phone calls. After a brief pause, he got the phone and kind of told me what had happened. And me being a young kid, I just asked him, "Does that mean we gotta go home now?" He just smiled and said, "No, we can keep playing." He was always so selfless with us. Dad was somewhat famous in a weird town kind of way with some of my baseball teams. Typically when a coach is working with you, you'll have a guy standing next to him, catching the balls that are coming back in, but not Dad. Somehow he figured out how to wear a glove on this hand and hold a bat in this hand. So he'd catch the balls we threw back into him, he'd flip it up to himself and hit it back out to us. He spent hours and hours doing that, and he was always willing to help out if anybody wanted to put in an extra kind of practice. We spent every weekend, it seemed like, going to some kind of a tournament or something. The amount of time and money that he sacrificed for us to play sports and to have something that we were good at, it's truly unbelievable. getting back to those kids. So if you're not familiar with an old show called Married with Children, yeah, a character named Al Bundy. This is probably not too much of you, but my dad needs to watch that show sometimes late at night when I'm supposed to be in bed. Spoiler alert. So that's it. Costco trips used to be kind of an ideal for our family. You know, three kids in tow, the grocery store can be kind of intimidating. And my dad managed to keep us under control by taking us through all the little snack lines there where all the samples are at. I think he used to send us over because after going through two or three times, I think he realized they wouldn't say no to the kids. So after one of these particular trips, he stopped at the exit and grabbed a comment card. And it proceeded to fill it out as follows. Thanks for lunch. The Bundys. I feel like my dad was a perfect combination between Clark Griswold and Al Bundy. He was just always having a great time. Through and through, I know my dad made an impact on everyone he was around. And I really strive for that in my life so that his legacy can move on. I have one final thank you to make. My mother is a very special human. Not many people would do what she's done for all these years. She spent countless hours at his side. She spent so much time in that place, she's probably registered nurse by now, we don't even know. Thank you for filling the gap as best you could. And for keeping our family from falling apart. We love you. So I'd now like to take the time to introduce one of my favorite people. Ms. Susie Tannenbaum, would you please come up?
John R. Burright, Jonathan Richard Burright, Trooper Burright, John B., Sergeant Burright, J.B., competitor, colleague, DUI hound, mentor, son, brother, husband, dad, and grandfather. There have been many names and titles that John had throughout his life. I'm sure there are many others that I don't know about. But one thing that was constant throughout John's life, John was a friend. He was my friend. So I met John in the early 90s. It was early in my career with Marion County Sheriff's Office, and he was, of course, with OSP. But we didn't meet on the road. We actually met on the softball diamond. We were both on our respective agencies' softball teams, competing against each other. There were legendary stories of John as a highly competitive, very athletic player who could crush the ball. I didn't believe it. But I thought I was competitive. Oh, no. John was competitive. He's the ultimate definition of competitive. I remember the fond memory that we had as teens when we played each other, and safe to say that OSP, led by the competitiveness and drive of JB, beat the socks off of us. It was really my first contact with John, and his competitiveness, and his passion for doing great things, but it most certainly was not my last. In 1994, a group of hand-selected DUI-centric officers were chosen to be in the first drug recognition expert school for the state of Oregon. So in early 1995, this amazing group of competitive, passionate individuals started this intense new program led by the great Chuck Hayes. I was fortunate enough to be in this class with the DUI legends of Trooper Ken Snook, Officer Jeff Durbin, Trooper Steve Webster, and of course, Trooper John Burright, as well as a few others. I was fortunate to know John more and more throughout this journey, becoming his colleague and his friend. During this class, as well as the first DRE instructor course, it was John's competitiveness, passion, and drive for doing his absolute best that pushed us as a group to obtain a very high percentage on quizzes and tests. He would always be there in the study sessions, leading the group with note cards and dry erase board diagrams, with the compassion and humor that he always had to get us through the class. We all wanted to succeed, but it was always John who wanted to get the highest score. Yeah, very competitive. He wanted to figure out the best way and succeed at the highest level because that's who he was. Competitive, stubborn, passionate, funny, smart. And it was these traits, as well as his inspiration to do the best, that truly drew my attention and admiration. On downtimes, he would talk about his amazing family, his incredible boys who he was always so proud of and hoped would become incredible men someday, and his wonderful wife, who had to be sassy enough to put up with his antics. He would say that he needed to do the best for them, otherwise the time away just wouldn't be right. He never hid his love and cried for his family. I felt like I knew you all, even before I really knew y'all. Years would pass, and we would teach standardized field sobriety testing and DRE together many times. John's sense of humor, his quick laugh, and his antics cracked me up constantly, like messing with the other instructors and students during the HGN portion of class, knowing full well that he had one pupil larger than the other from a past injury, which, you know, for us would mean like head trauma, so people would be concerned, but for him, he thought that it was really funny because he feigned his shock and surprise when the students told him about their concerning discovery. He finally did let them in on the joke. He thought it was pretty funny. But he made learning fun and relatable to the students. He taught many officers to love and appreciate good DUI and DRE investigations. He mentored many throughout his career and shared his law enforcement passion. As friends and colleagues, we would meet up during shifts with other DUI hounds to talk about family, kids, and the occasional strange arrest that we just had. Every time, John's biggest brag was always his boys. What sports they were playing, how they were doing in school, how tall they were getting. He loved you guys so much and was always so proud of you. Even while working, you were always his reason for doing good things and never far from his mind. The day the crash happened, I was working patrol in the canyon. I knew it was bad. Like most of the officers that were around during that time, I mourned the loss of Jason and Maria. I was also deeply concerned about my friend John, about his injuries and his status. I had to follow his journey, see if I could help in some way, or at least give him and his family my support. I'd always hoped for the best, knowing he was strong, stubborn, and determined. Not long after the crash, I was able to contact and meet up with John's wife, Rhonda. Felt like I knew her through John's stories and his admiration. We shared stories through laughs and tears, continue to this day, because of his impact within the law enforcement community through the help of DPSST, ODOT, and Steve Vitolo, we were able to create the Perpetual Sergeant John Burright Supervisor of the Year Award. It was always an honor to present that award with Ron and the boys to deserving patrol supervisors, some of you which may be here today. Somehow during this journey over the years, Rhonda became one of my closest friends. I got to know the boys, watched them grow up into fantastic men. And I was privileged to continue my friendship with John. It was different after the crash. When I visit, I was the one who got to talk most, which I always gave him a hard time about. He would still laugh his fantastic laugh, give his extreme and epic eye rolls. And I was honored to observe the understood language of love and compassion between John and his family. It grew into a new normal for all of us. Through treatments and new technology tries, John worked hard to progress. John still lived. He got to experience things. He loved. He was loved. He was taken care of, and he kept fighting for almost 20 years after the crash. We gladly met John where he was at, so we could experience his expressions of love, laughter, compassion, trickery, stubbornness, sadness, and friendship in a new way, but always John's way. In the almost 20 years he was in the Mennonite home, while he had new barriers, he was always surrounded by family, friends, and an amazing group of caregivers and healthcare providers that I'm going to put in the family category because of the extraordinary care and attention they gave John. I would like those caregivers to stand right now so we can appreciate and give mine and the family's sincerest thank you to many of those caregivers that are here today. Thank you, guys. You all know you mean so much to all of us, the family, everybody, so thank you for everything you did. Throughout his journey, Johnny Mee loved his audible books as well as his fart noisemaker. He never lost his boy sense of humor. He really enjoyed his naps. He was a big napper. He loved the Beach Boys. And he loved it when his caregivers would try everything in their power to make him laugh. Personally, I just think he liked the attention from the ladies, but he really enjoyed watching his sons play sports through live streaming, as well as seeing them grow to become amazing men who have both of their parents' qualities of competitiveness, compassion, humor, warmth, strength, smarts, and just a bit of stubbornness. He loved his wife deeply. Rhonda could read John like no other, and she loved him beyond any words could express. He loved his family and friends, and he got to experience some incredible things in his life. For me, I was blessed to know John before and after the crash. I got to see him in different lights, but those strong characteristics remained constant, and I gained a beautiful friend in Rhonda, and got the honor to watch the family grow. John taught me so much about strength, might, perseverance, love, compassion, competitiveness, but mostly what's most important in this world, family. Above it all, John was a family man, through and through, and he and Rhonda raised three tremendous sons. And John and Rhonda have been blessed with two, for now, amazing and adorable grandchildren, who John did make and knew. Kyle, Jeremy, Nolan, you are your dad's legacy. You have his incredible traits and characteristics. There's no doubt you are Burright men. Your dad was and always will be so proud of you. And Rhonda, you know how much John adored you and cherished you. With all of your sassiness, you are always his rock, his strong advocate, the love of his life, his one. So, my dear friend John, wherever you are, running with the angels, playing basketball or baseball in the heavens, thank you from all of us for being a role model, a mentor, a comedian, a smart guy, competitor, a guardian, and friend. I'll miss you, buddy. So I would now like to introduce, like I said in my speech, the amazing and great Chuck Hayes.
Okay, after that introduction, I'm not sure I can live up to that, but I'll try. So, as Susie just said, I'm Chuck Hayes, and retired from the Oregon State Police, retired captain. I retired back in 2003, but it's just a pleasure, honor, to be here today, to be able to get up here and talk about John. I had the extreme pleasure of working with John for a number of years, well over 10 years, actually. I was actually part of his recruit school, and so back in those days, I got to go over and teach DUI, and so that was when I first met John. I had heard about John coming up to a law enforcement family, and so kind of had great expectations for John early on in my career as I met him, and he started with the Oregon State Police, and I can tell you that those expectations exceeded everything that I thought of, and he was just a great, great person to work with. So I'm going to tell a little bit about some of the experiences I had with working with John, and Susie did a great job talking about some of these things as well. So John actually started his career and was assigned to the Roseburg Patrol Office and then transferred up about 2 years on the department and came up to the Albany Patrol Office. And so that was back about 1989, and I then transferred in November of 1989 to be the station commander at the Albany Patrol Office. And so when I got there, we had a fairly, older office, and so to just see this young trooper coming in and just to see all of the, just all of the enthusiasm that John had. And it was great to see this because I'm the new station commander, trying to, work my way through and, get acquainted with everybody, so to speak, at the Albany office. Well, John was just one of those immediate leaders within the office. And so I just loved his enthusiasm that he brought forth when he came to that office. And so I'm going to talk a little bit about that because his impact, he was one of those guys that you could tell they just had this passion for working patrol, and then he also had this great passion and enthusiasm for working impaired driving enforcement. And so he turned out to be one of our best DUI enforcement officers, troopers that we had in the Albany office. And I thought that was great because that kind of set the tone and also helped with some of the other officers that we had. And as Susie talked about, back in those days, back in 1989, actually, we didn't have a drug recognition expert program in the state of Oregon. We didn't get that until 1995, as Susie talked about, with our original school, after we were approved as kind of as a pilot by the International Association of Chiefs of Police. And so, back in 1989, I was really the only DRE in the state of Oregon, and so my job was, we're going to try to start this program, get this program, this very elite program, started in Oregon. And so there were 23 states in the program at that time, and I definitely hoped that Oregon would be the 24th state, and so with a lot of work that actually happened. And so I started kind of recruiting, as Susie talked about, trying to find the best of the best out there around the state when it came to DUI enforcement so that we could actually start this very first school in 1995 off on the right foot. And hopefully take some of those original officers that are trained as drug recognition experts and then turn them into DRE instructors. And so Susie was one of those, John was one of those as well. But I gotta tell you, John had this knack for DUI enforcement, and he did a lot of DUI enforcement, but yet trying to talk to him and convince him to do something as DRE and to go to that really next step, elite step, really, to become a drug recognition expert, it was kind of difficult. But I do remember one thing that happened that kind of helped with this entire process. And so John and I were actually part of working a nighttime DUI saturation in Linn County, and as a lieutenant, I like to go out and do that as well. And so I hear John making this traffic stop in downtown Albany, and so he's asking if I would come by, and so he calls me on the radio, and he goes, can you meet me here on this traffic stop? So I went and contacted him in downtown Albany, and so he comes up to me and he goes, okay, he goes, I got a rear window mirror. And so he's telling me that this guy driving bad, all over the road, but I can't smell any alcohol on him, there's all of these weird things going. So he said, I'm not sure if the guy's just weird or what's going on. And so I said, okay, let's go talk to him. And so we go up and end up making that contact with that driver. And as a result, we find out that that driver had drank 2 bottles of cough medicine. And so that was his sort of drug of choice. And so I told John, I said, okay, so this guy, if he's drinking cough medicine, chances are he's impaired, especially when you drink two bottles of it. And so as a result of that, I told John, let's go ahead and do field sobriety. You're a standardized field sobriety testing instructor, so let's put him through the test. And he goes, yeah, but the guy's not drunk. And I said, yeah, but let's go ahead and still do that. So as a real result, John did the standardized field sobriety test, did them exactly the way that you're supposed to do, as he would. And so definitely showed that he was impaired. And so it's like he comes back to me and he goes, okay, what do I do now? And I said, well, you should arrest him. He's under the influence. And he goes, yeah, but if it's cop medicine, we can't really charge him with that. And I said, well, we don't really know that, John. And so this really gave me a chance to talk about DRE to John. And so as a result, John ended up making that arrest. We did a drug evaluation, which showed that he was impaired. And I'll tell you, from that point on, John Burright was sold on the Drug Recognition Expert Program. This was like a new toy for him. I mean, he was like the most excited kid, and it was like all of a sudden now he goes, wow. He goes, okay, there are so many people that probably were impaired out there that I let go that I didn't even know about, but now that's never going to happen again. And so as a result of that, John did go through the first DRE school back in 1995 along with Susie. And so then, after a while, I'm trying to convince him, okay, John, you are the perfect person to go out and actually be an instructor, to train other people. And it was like, oh, no, I'm terrible at standing in front of the classroom. No, I don't think you are. I said, you have that presence where people listen to you. I mean, you're so passionate about what you do, and you come across as so genuine, as Susie talked about, you're the ideal person to go up and do some of this kind of instructing and then to train other people. I kind of looked at John almost like the silent servant leader. And so, because not only was he that way as a trooper, but then definitely when he got promoted later on to becoming a sergeant, just other troopers just looked up to him. And whatever John said, it was kind of like, okay, you know, people listened to him because they respected him so much. And so as a result, John was sold on DRE. It took us a while here to get the program started in Oregon, but in 1995, as I said, we got the program started. John became one of the original instructors. And I remember John telling me, the next DRE school we were going to have, it's like after he became an instructor, it's like, okay, John, I need for you to teach. And it was like, no, I don't really want to teach. He didn't like getting up in front of the classroom, but we would put him with people like Susie, and so that really worked out well to have them team teach. But yet, John was one of the best when it would come to doing the actual field certifications, is what we would call it. And so that's where you would go to some facility, and we were using downtown Portland at that time, where we would do drug evaluations on suspected impaired drivers. And I'll tell you what, John Burright had the knack. I mean, he was one of the best when it came to mentoring people and showing them how to do these things. And so he did it exactly by the book, just the way that you're supposed to train. And I think it was like more of the students wanted to flock to John so that John could actually watch them and teach them how to do their drug evaluations. That was just kind of the person John Burright was. I mean, he was just so dedicated and so thorough in everything he did. So it was good to get him into the DRE program and later become a DRE instructor. And like I said, he was a silent leader, so to speak, that silent servant leader. And so I can remember, you know, him coming from a law enforcement background in his family, I think that really did help. But yet, he truly loved the Oregon State Police. And one of the things that I just admired so much about John Burright, as I was the lieutenant there in the Albany office, is that he would come to work every day with this just fantastic attitude. I mean, he had that big smile, kind of like on this picture right up in front of me here. He had that smile on his face every day when he would come to work. I don't ever think that there was a bad day that John Burright had when he would show up to the office and it's like, okay, you know, I got this little chip on my shoulder or something's going on, because he was just always ready to go out on work patrol. And I can remember this many times, that big smile on his face. He'd come into the office, he would usually contact me, come to my office, or go to the sergeant's office with that big smile, that big grin, and ask, okay, how's our day going? Is there anything I can do? Is there anything that I can do to help you guys out? You know, it's like, okay, taking the calls that maybe some other troopers didn't want to take, John Burright would always take them. He would always take some of the other stuff that maybe wasn't too popular with some of the other troops in the office. And so I also remember this with John as well, is that I wish we had a photograph of this, but John Burright wearing his campaign hat. Okay, when we teach in recruit school to wear your campaign hat and you later, you know, become a trooper, well, I was in the honor guard as well. We always kind of taught you, you keep that campaign hat and stick two fingers up here on the bridge of your nose, and that was kind of how you wore it. No, not John. John always had that hat tilted back, and so his forehead was showing. And so here we come, walking down the hallway in the ultimate control office with that campaign hat back on the back of his head. But yeah, that was John. That was just the way he did things. But you know what? I mean, that was just one of those kind of little quirks and attributes of John. But as I said, he really had a way of lighting up the patrol office. And he was also one of those guys that he wanted to get out on patrol. So he would show up early to start his shift. And I can remember so many times, because back in those days at the Albany Patrol Office, we actually had a pretty good number, a large number of troopers there at that office. And we actually had sometimes more troopers than we had patrol cars. And when that happened to John Burright, I mean, it was like an emergency catastrophe. Because when John Burright was ready to start his shift at 3 o'clock or 4 o'clock, by golly, he wanted a patrol car. And so if a patrol car wasn't available for him, he was coming into me, Lieutenant, what am I going to do? Can I take your car, Lieutenant? And there were many times when I would give him the keys to my car, and it was like, okay, because I could just tell. If I didn't give him the car, he was just going to burn out the carpet walking back and forth to the patrol office because he wanted to get out there so bad. And so that was something that was just, I always remember that as well. And then John Burright, as you heard from Susie, a lot of different titles, a lot of different things to describe him. But we also have to remember that he was a hero. And so when I was the lieutenant in the Albany office, well, I had a great number of troopers there. But it was just prior to John going to DRE school in 1995 that there was a call of a crash on Interstate 5. And so some of you may remember this. And so John and Rich Pelleggi, who is here today, they responded to this crash on Interstate 5. And so a man was trapped inside the car. And that car then caught on fire. And so these troopers, John and Rich, had to make a decision. And that decision could have cost them their lives. And so they responded, and they actually got that man out of that burning car just before it actually exploded and went into flames. And so not only would the driver have died, but there's a very good possibility we could have lost them both as a result of that car crash and it exploding and catching on fire. Sadly, the driver did die later on. But then, Oregon State Police Lieutenant Leron Howland, he made a quote, which I think is just kind of shows exactly what kind of person John was. And the man's death did not diminish the courage of the officers. And so, again, John and Rich being heroes. Well, I had the pleasure then of actually making sure and being involved in the ceremony and presenting the Holly Holcomb Award, which is one of the most prestigious awards that any trooper, any member of the Oregon State Police could ever receive. And that was one of my finest moments, was to just present this award not only to John, but also to Rich Pelleggi for their life-saving actions that they did. And then, as Susie talked about, John was competitive. Yes, he was competitive, and so I am going to expound upon that as well, Susie. And so, not only at softball, but really, John's sport was basketball. And so he loved to play basketball, and so some of you maybe might remember this, but John had this really great idea that there was a Saturday morning Albany Recreational League basketball league that was starting up. And so John is recruiting people in the Albany Patrol Office and also getting some other people from local agencies. And it's like he's going to form this team of law enforcement. We're going to be a bunch of cops, and we're going to be out there playing basketball on Saturday morning in this Albany Rec League. And so it was probably worse than the YMCA league because it got a little heated, got a little chippy at times. And so it doesn't help either when everybody that you're playing against knows that this is all a bunch of cops. And so they were taking a little bit of advantage with this sometimes. But I do remember on one Saturday morning, and that was a game that really was getting a little bit heated. And so I was in there, and of course, I'm not probably the best person to have on the floor at the time when things are getting heated, because I was a wee bit competitive as well. And so I do remember that things were getting so chippy that Big John went up for a rebound one day, And so it was like, I'm going to clear out everybody underneath that basket. And so John's elbows were flying as he got that rebound, and all I can remember was his big elbow coming towards my face. The next thing I remember, I am on the floor, and I am looking up at everybody, and it's just a bunch of stars and blurriness. And John is standing over me, and he's apologizing profusely. Big John took me out with that elbow. And so, you know, at the time, it was kind of like, okay, just the heat of the battle. But after a while, I was maybe thinking, okay, maybe John did that on purpose because I was getting a little bit too excited. Maybe I was one of the agitators, which, yeah, I had a tendency to do sometimes. But yet, that was one of the, I think, the things that John loved the most was that Saturday morning recreational basketball team that we had and that he organized. And then, you know, it was kind of funny, too, because John felt so bad about that I can remember him coming into my office, starting swing shift, and every time he'd come to the office, the first thing he'd do is to come in and check on me to make sure I was okay, because he felt so bad about taking me out that day with his elbow. You know, John did some other things, too, that were, you know, we talked about some of the mischievous things that he did, but I thought this one was really cute. And that was one day when I'm not at the office, and you boys, I don't know if you remember this or not, but John dressed you all up in state police trooper outfits, and so you went into my office, and you basically, you know, you had a little fun with my office, which was good. You put things where I probably couldn't find them for months, you know, and, you know, stole my color crayons. No, you didn't do that. But it was actually showing, he put them all on my desk, and then in their state police shirts and badges and with their campaign hats on, and took a picture of that. I still have that picture today, which is really something that I cherish. Well, I knew John had the makings of being a great supervisor. I mean, he just was one of those people, as you heard Susie talk about, he genuinely cared for other people. And so John was one of those guys that, okay, you could always count on. And so to me, he was somebody that, yes, someday he's going to make an outstanding supervisor. And so he had that kind of that attitude that I get to, instead of I got to. And so I get to instead of I got to. And that was the way that he kind of led his career. Everything that he did for the Oregon State Police was something that he cherished and was enthusiastic about. I mean, I could give him some of the worst assignments, like going out and doing VIN checks in the parking lot. We had to crawl underneath some, you know, car to check somebody's VIN. John would always do it with a big smile on his face. You know, never anything that came back from him. Well, I kind of summarize John, you know, when I think about some of the things about him, not only being a husband, a father, a competitor, but also a supervisor as well. And there's this one passage, this one poem, so to speak, called The Measure of a Man. And so I want to read this because I think when, in my mind, probably in your mind, when we think about John Burright and what kind of person he was, let's just see if many of these things apply to him. The measure of a man is not determined by his show of outward strength, or by the volume of his voice, or by the thunder of his actions, or of his intellect or academic abilities. It is seen rather in terms of the love that he has for his family and for everyone. The strength of his commitments, the genuineness of his fellowships, the sincerity of his purpose, the quiet courage of his convictions, the fun, the laughter, joy, and happiness he gives to his family and to others, his love of life, his patience and his honesty, and his commitment to what he has. To me, that describes John Burright. Not only as a member of the Oregon State Police, but also as a family man, a husband, and as a good friend. John and I, we kind of went our separate ways. When he got promoted, he went to the Sales Patrol Office about that same time. I went to General Headquarters. But yet, we remained friends through all of that. And I actually got to kind of keep in friendship with the family as well. The boys were growing, going their separate ways. But yet, we still maintain that friendship. And so, I do remember one time going and visiting him. when he was being carried by these people back here, and thank you so much for all of the care that you did for him. I actually got to see that many times when I visited, and Judy and I visited my wife. So one day, I probably got in trouble, but I went in there, and so here's Don. And so he seemed to be like in a little bit of a bad mood, which, okay, that's, you know, to be expected sometimes. And so I started talking about basketball with him. And you could just tell that, okay, all of a sudden things were changing in him. And I reminded him of the time that he hit me with his elbow and took me out. And I said, "You big goober?" Well, when I called him the big goober, he actually burst out laughing. I mean, so loud that one of the caretakers, one of the people who were working there, came down the hallway to find out exactly what was going on. I thought I was going to get kicked out of the place for calling him the big goober. But he thought that was pretty funny. Well, I'll tell you what, John Burright definitely had a calling. And so there's many of us in law enforcement, many of you here today. Okay, people like John Burright and others, we sometimes enter law enforcement, maybe often as idealists, who believe that we can make a difference in the lives of others. Well, I can tell you without a doubt, without any exception, John Burright made the difference and made a difference in so many people's lives. And not only with the people that he worked with, his fellow law enforcement, but also just the people that he contacted and came in contact here as the citizens of this state. I had so many people that complimented John Burright on a traffic stop. People would come in and talk to me about a citation or how to take care of it. And oh, by the way, that trooper was the nicest trooper I had ever met, ever had any contact with. That was the kind of guy John Burright was. He was a joy to supervise, and I cherish those moments and always will cherish those moments that I had a chance to be with John and to work with John. He taught me a lot, as he did a lot of other people as well. I look at it and I say, you know what? We're all blessed to know John. I was blessed to work with him. And also, we were blessed to be part of his life as well. All right, I'm going to turn it over now. My pleasure to introduce Captain Tim Fox of the Oregon State Police as our next speaker.
In answer to your questions, yes and no. Yes, I was at the DRE trying to be recruited me, and no, I'm not Dr. Fox joking. Good afternoon. It is my privilege today to speak about my friend and colleague, John Burright. Rhonda, boys, thank you for the song. I draw so much inspiration from y'all, your pillars of strength and grace, and I love you. Friends, colleagues, and fellow Oregon State Police troopers, thank you all for being here today. On behalf of the agency and the Burright family, your presence is both comforting and reassuring. They shall neither shun responsibility nor shrink from duty in the face of danger. The current and retired OSP troopers present here today know the significance of those words and the price paid to uphold them. For those not familiar, I'll elaborate in a moment. When Rhonda asked that I say a few words today, I was honestly terrified, but not for the reasons you may think. Of course, this is a speech that no friend ever wants to give in front of such a solemn group. But it was not those thoughts that most troubled me. It was something far more unnerving. You see, I also have dozens of stories to tell about John. Funny stories about John that would lighten the mood and bring a smile to your face. A welcome relief for our heavy hearts. Serious stories of John's bravery that will make his sons and co-workers swell with pride. I also have plenty of those. Or maybe speak to John's compassion and how he always treated others with such dignity. Excuse me. Then again, I could fill my time with those stories of the seemingly endless love he had for his wife and sons. There's not enough time in the day for that, to cover that topic. John is my friend and my hero, so I've got no shortage of topics to discuss. The problem I alluded to earlier would frighten me about what I might say is to assemble words that will do justice to John's rightful legacy as one of OSP's volunteers. I swear I was going to do this. It's your fault. To simply speak about my experience with John, I'm afraid it falls so very short. Because, in my opinion, I still selfishly want to keep those stories alive because it highlights I was part of his life. Those stories are my observations, and some even held my participation, but they do not speak to the weight of John's legacy. If you haven't visited the Oregon State Police Volunteer Memorial, located on the north side of the state capitol, I highly encourage you to do so. The broken column at the memorial, signifying life interrupted, stands sentry in front of the names of our honored fallen. When you visit the wall, you'll find these simple words prominently engraved among those that gave all. They shall neither shun responsibility nor shrink from duty in the face of danger. Every OSP trooper that takes the oath of office silently pledges to uphold this promise. While all my pledge to uphold the agency honor, some like John have paid the ultimate price for service. I've sat silently at the wall countless times, with my eyes always drawn to that blank tile, patiently awaiting the next name. In silent prayer, I've asked this tile blank. But knowing that is unlikely, and it would eventually bear the name of another brother or sister, and now we know the new name that will grace the memorial. Oregon State Police Sergeant John Burright is the 34th OSP trooper following the line of duty. Sergeant Burright will take his place on the fallen trooper memorial today, occupying a blank tile in the bottom right-hand corner of the memorial alongside his fellow heroes. John now belongs to all of us, and his legacy will outlive cracking voice, every person in attendance today. This is why my personal stories fall so short when I need to speak to the solemn honor of this occasion. 32 brothers and one sister welcome John home today as he assumes his rightful place in OSP's history, along their side. A history of service, a history of sacrifice, a history of 34 Oregon State Police troopers that went to work for Oregon and never returned home at the end of their shifts. Their shared sacrifice is only eclipsed by their families who somehow move forward through their grief. John's legacy, along with the other fallen troopers, is now woven into the OSP fabric, which is strengthened by their sacrifice. Generations of Oregonians and family members will pay tribute to their legacy as they pay the ultimate respect, which is to remember. Remember what they stood for, remember they loved, remember they lived, and remember they gave all. Thank you again to all that made this trip today. I especially want to thank Bronwyn and the boys for this opportunity to take part of your lives. As we all honor John's legacy and life today, I hope you all find peace and comfort from one another's company. It's my honor to introduce 6'7", starting forward, middle son, Jeremy. Thank you.
So glad you guys are all here. This mic is way fun, yeah. I am a guy, and my kryptonite, along with my brother, is support. Seeing people honor somebody else, whether it's on America's Got Talent, or this absolutely beautiful ceremony that's happened today, I want to start by saying thank you to all of you. To all of you that are part of the session, Timmy, for being a part of our family, Susie, I'm not going to talk about my brother right now, bad idea, and to the rest of you. This is quite the interesting funeral. We're here to celebrate and mourn something that happened 20 years ago in a month. And some of you didn't get the pleasure, the opportunity to meet that second dad that I had. And there's a word that's been passed around so much today. It's legacy. And if I can give each and every one of you one gift today, it's to allow that legacy to be passed along to you. And allow that fabric to be sewn into your hearts and to your families. I learned the greatest lesson from my dad that I'm going to pass along to you. There was mischievousness, of course, but I'm going to go ahead and keep that one for ourselves. I didn't know that I was second in line to the married with children nights. Mostly because Powell didn't get caught. I apparently am a loud human being with everything that I do. And so my mom, and we hear my mom come in, hi. So I'd be behind the chair as she walked out. She looked down, John, where's your son? And he has two ice cream cones in his hand, not one. I haven't seen him. So there's plenty of fun, mischievous things that I can talk about today. It was part of my dad and part of the fun that he brought into my life to tell myself it's okay to take life a little more fun, even in moments like this. He taught me a very valuable lesson at a young age, too, that I had no ceiling. Ever. I was 4 years old. And my dad was coaching with that wonderful man back there, Jerry Weekly. My dad was on the bench, let him play, let him play. The thing is, every player on the court was age 8. And it was my brother's team. Jerry's like, I don't want to get hurt. He'll be fine. He'll be fine. He always taught me that I could compete, I could be with anybody in the world because he believed in himself. And it's something I call normalizing. When you're around somebody that believes that much in themselves and they're passionate about what they do, you believe as well. It's why people flock to John. Why people flock to my dad. It wasn't because of how good he was at a DRE expert. It was because of who he was as a human being. And it's the legacy that I love passing along myself. But the greatest lesson was true love. If I didn't go out and hang out with him and watch late night television, we probably shouldn't be watching, he'd come to my room. He rubbed my head. See, that eruption. This 6'2", shotgun carrying, SWAT loving competitor was also a loving dad to all of us. See, that eruption, he rubbed my head. And the best thing about true love is you love not to be loved in return, you love to love. Because I was an 8-year-old, 6-year-old, 9-year-old kid that wasn't ready to love his daddy at that time. I pretend to be asleep sometimes because it embarrassed me by myself to feel that much love from another human being, much less a man. So I didn't always get the chance to say I love you back. After he was hurt, I asked my uncle David a question one time that I love very much. I said, how do you go in there? How do you go in there and hang out with a man that can't give you love in return? He laughs, he plays, he eyeballs, and it was all that. But there was moments where I was like, Dad, what do you think about this? I have a big decision to make in my life. And he couldn't respond. And so instead, I started rubbing his head. I said, Jeremy loves you. And I kissed him on his forehead. And I told him he's going to be all right. And I believed in him, there was no ceiling, that there was a chance he could be better. I always believed in him. My mom knew, the week before he died. I said, maybe if we change his diet a little bit, maybe if we can do something. I always believed because he believed. And the legacy that I want to pass along to you is from him. We do not love to be loved in return. The dog does not lick him in the face if he licked back. He only licks. It's the greatest lesson I ever got. Every single time I left that room over the last 20 years, I was crying, bawling in my car by myself. Because I had loved and I couldn't receive love in return. So if there's anything that I want you guys to take away, it's a legacy that I want to be sown into your hearts. It's to love. And to not love to get anything back, but just to love.
What a wonderful set of pictures. Thank you to those who were able to put those pictures together. What a great depiction of a life well lived. And my goodness, the stories, the humor, the inspiration, appreciation to Kyle, to Susie, to Chuck, to Tim, and to Jeremy for those stories, those inspirations. Every once in a while in life, you get to stand and honor somebody who really, really made a difference in the world. And that was John Burright. Just a few thank yous. First of all, thanks to all of you for attending this important event. Your presence here is a great comfort to John's family, and they have asked that I express their truly heartfelt appreciation to you for being here. I would also like to thank the Oregon State Police and the Oregon Fallen Badge Foundation, as well as the Oregon State Police retirees and various volunteers for their combined work in bringing all this together and providing support for this service today. Now, we're going to turn the balance of the program over to the rendering of the police honors. Again, thank you.
Negative contact.